How long could the Tampa Bay Buccaneers be without linebacker Lavonte David, and how bad is it really if he does have to miss time? That and more coming up on this episode of Locked On Bucs.
You are Locked On Buccaneers, your daily Tampa Bay Buccaneers podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
What's up, Bucs fans, and welcome to this episode of Locked On Bucs, your daily podcast covering the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. Thank you so much for making Locked On Bucs your first listen of the day every day. And don't forget that you can subscribe for free on YouTube or wherever you get your podcasts. And you can follow along on Twitter with me, your host, David Harrison, at dharrison82 on Twitter and on Threads. You can also find my work as a credentialed member of the media covering your Buccaneers for BucsGameDay.com, a part of Sports Illustrated's Fan Nation. And you can become a Locked On Bucs insider. Get texts directly from James Yarcho, expertise, analysis, opinion, and maybe even some hockey dad updates. Those are always fun. Just go to joinsubtext.com/LockedOnBucs to get in on that action. James runs the account. I'm a subscriber myself. It's a good time. You should come in there and join us on that venture. Every dayers, we appreciate you being here every day like you are. Today's episode is brought to you by Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, use the promo code Locked On NFL, and you'll get $20 off your first purchase. Last minute tickets, lowest price guaranteed. On today's episode of Locked On Bucs, we're talking about Todd. Todd said some interesting things that I've got some opinions on. I was about to say interesting opinions on. I think they're interesting opinions. We'll see if you think they're interesting opinions. And we're stashing and trashing from the Week 11 loss for the Buccaneers, suffered 27-14 to the San Francisco 49ers. But first, can the Tampa Bay Buccaneers survive without linebacker Lavonte David? So if you caught the live episode following the game, James dove into the injuries that the Buccaneers suffered. As of the time of this recording, don't have any official updates, but there is some reason to be concerned specifically about Lavonte David. And given current trends, no, I don't know that the Tampa Bay Buccaneers can survive without Lavonte David. The first question, though, is will they even have to? And obviously, if we're having this discussion, I'm telling you that I believe the Buccaneers will have to be without Lavonte David for at least a little bit of time. According to Jenna Lane of ESPN, she tweeted out on Monday evening, quote, "I'm told that early indications are that it's a groin strain for Bucs inside linebacker Lavonte David, per source. An MRI will provide more detail," end quote. So according to my research, because I'm not a doctor, but according to my research, my heavy Googling, even if it's a mild groin strain, the research I've done, and after I slept in a Holiday Inn Express last night, Lavonte David is likely going to miss 3 to 6 weeks of action. So you definitely hope it's the three. You definitely hope maybe it was just the California weather made it feel worse than it was, and actually it's okay. He just sneezed wrong and he'll be fine. But Lavonte David's a tough dude. So for Lavonte David to leave a game and not come back, it's probably a legit thing, right? That's the downside of being a tough guy, is that when you go down, it's probably a legit reason that you're going down. So if Lavonte has to miss 3 to 6 weeks, those three games minimum are the Indianapolis Colts on the road next week, the Carolina Panthers, the Atlanta Falcons. Truthfully, this team should be able to beat the Carolina Panthers and even the Atlanta Falcons. I know they already lost to them once, but they should be able to beat the Atlanta Falcons as well, even without Lavonte David. Should be. That's the big thing, right? The Colts are more tricky, right? I think the Colts are a little bit difficult, are a little bit more difficult to handle. Obviously, the Falcons are going to be difficult, but I still think you can pull that off if you do some things that James and I are going to talk about here in the second segment. But even with a loss to the Indianapolis Colts, right, this is really the big question. It's not necessarily can the Tampa Bay Buccaneers win or lose games without Lavonte David. Like, you know, two of the three, I say yes, they can if they need to, if they have to. The question is, are they dead in the water without Lavonte David? If they lose to the Indianapolis Colts and they beat the Carolina Panthers and the Atlanta Falcons, and the rest of the NFC schedule goes the way that I see it going, the great saving grace is that this weekend the Saints and Falcons play each other. So they're one of them is going to knock off the other one. Either way, the Buccaneers are coming out of that thing with some sort of a benefit, right? The Bucs would have, if it goes the way I see it going, the Bucs would have matching 6-7 records with the New Orleans Saints. And of course, it's a losing record. You don't want to celebrate a losing record, but because of the tiebreaker, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers would be leading the NFC South and would be sitting in the fourth seed in the NFC playoff picture. But losing Lavonte David for any amount of time, bottom line, is going to put even more pressure on Devin White. So getting outside of the overall team picture, which doesn't look as terrible if you really keep things in perspective. James mentioned it during a live that, you know, it's the NFC South. So fortunately, it gives you a little bit more grace. You know, we've talked about it pretty much all season long that nine wins is most likely going to win this division this season. But specifically, the pressure is going to ratchet up on Devin White. Not that it hasn't been turned up already because of his play, his performance, his behavior on social media, all those things, right? But losing Lavonte David certainly turns up the heat on Devin. Devin in week 11 against the 49ers had only three tackles. He missed two tackles according to PFF and gave up three catches on three targets for 30 yards and a touchdown. This wasn't three touchdowns. We had a string of threes going on there. So at least it wasn't three touchdowns, but not a good day at the office for Devin White. Devin White alone allowed Brock Purdy a 147.9 QBR on Sunday alone. Of course, Brock finishing with a perfect QBR. So Devin wasn't alone in that issue, right? But getting down into the grades a little bit, Lavonte David's season grade so far this season, he's had an overall defensive grade of 66, a run grade of run defense grade of 70.5, tackling grade of 63.7, pass rush grade of 64.4, coverage grade of 61.4. All of those are in the green to light green range. So mostly positives, right? Devin White season grades this season, according to PFF, overall 37.4. Run defense, 31.7. Tackling, 77.4. Pass rush, 61.4. Coverage grade, 42.8. The only grade that Devin White has better than Lavonte David so far this season is his tackling grade. But his tackling grade in week 11 was just 28.3. So even in the area where he is outperforming Lavonte David, according to PFF, he was much, much worse in the week 11 loss to the San Francisco 49ers. Now, Lavonte David's season grades, it's important for context, are below the median. Lavonte David's, this is his 12th season. So the top six seasons are the top, the bottom six seasons are the bottom. The median, you're looking at like years 9 through 11, right? Lavonte David's grades this season, most of them are below the median for his career outside of his pass rush grade, which is fifth in his 12 seasons. Only Devin White's pass rush grade and tackling grades this season would not be career lows for Lavonte David. That is the separation in performance from these two players. I know a lot of people don't like the PFF grade system, but at least both of these players, these grades compared side by side, they're being compared in the same metrics. So it just shows you the divide. Even if you don't like the number specifically, it shows you the divide between the two. And Lavonte David is in coverage much more often than Devin White, while White is the main rush off-ball linebacker for obvious reasons. So if the Bucs can't rely on Devin White to replace Lavonte David's play to a reasonable level, because they're going to need to use him more in pass coverage if he's that guy, that leaves that task to guys like KJ Britt, Servassier Dennis, maybe a role of safety down there as kind of like a Buffalo nickel linebacker type hybrid. I don't know what the Buccaneers are going to do, guys, but if they're missing Lavonte David for 3 to 6 weeks, like it looks like they might have to do, fingers crossed that this is overreaction. But if that's the case, things are going to get real sticky for Devin White, and that's going to make beating the Colts, Panthers, and Falcons a little bit more tricky. I think, you know, like I said, you know, prematurely, I think it makes the Colts game a lot harder to win. I think the Panthers, you should be all right either way. Atlanta Falcons, obviously, that makes that sticky as well. But if they do some of the things that I recommend they keep, if they toss some of the things that James and I recommend they toss coming into next week from week 11, then they should be an improved picture across the board, even if they're without Lavonte David for these next three games. I'll tell you what those things are coming up next on today's episode of Locked On Bucs, part of Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. And this episode of Locked On Bucs brought to you by Game Time. You shouldn't have to worry when you're buying tickets to your next big event. And with Game Time, you get the fastest and easiest way to buy tickets for all your sports, music, comedy, and theater events near you. If you want to catch the next Buccaneers home game, you can go to Game Time, find cheap tickets, get the exact information, see the view from your seat, all of it, because they're the only ticketing app that gives you complete peace of mind with your purchase. The view from your seat tells you exactly what you're going to expect to see when you arrive. So if you've never been to Ray J or if you've never been to Lucas Oil and you want to catch the Colts game next weekend, you'll know exactly what your view is going to give you. All in prices show your total up front as well, so you know you're getting a great deal with no hidden fees. Game Time has deals on tickets right up to the start of the event and even an hour after it starts. Maybe wake up Sunday, you're like, you know what? I do want to go see a football game. Go get those tickets to Lucas Oil Stadium. See the Buccaneers take on the Indianapolis Colts. It's the place to find last minute seats. Take the guesswork out of buying tickets with Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, use the promo code LOCKEDONNFL for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply. Again, create an account and redeem the code LOCKEDONNFL for $20 off. Download Game Time today. Last minute tickets, lowest price guaranteed. This show is also sponsored by BetterHelp. I look forward to the holiday season every single year. Thanksgiving, Christmas, my youngest birthday, they all happen to happen right around the same 30-day stretch from each other. And there's even the fresh feeling of New Year's that comes right after that. But it's also during the final regular season stretch of the NFL schedule. The NBA schedule is rolling forward, and I cover the Washington Wizards. And I start to get ready for the Senior Bowl. I start getting ready for the Skyline Combine, making travel arrangements, doing all those things. Bottom line is, this time of year can be a lot. And it's natural for me, for you, for anybody to feel a little bit of stress, a little bit of anxiety about it. Are you making everybody happy? Are you satisfying all of your needs, all of your responsibilities? Well, therapy can be a bright spot amid all of the stress. It can be something that makes you feel grounded and gives you the tools to manage everything going on. It's helpful to learn positive coping skills and how you can set boundaries for yourself. It empowers you to be the best version of you. And it isn't just for those who have experienced major trauma. If you're thinking of starting therapy, give BetterHelp a try. It's entirely online, designed to be convenient, flexible, and suited to your schedule. Find your bright spot this season with BetterHelp. Visit BetterHelp.com/LockedOn today to get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/LockedOn. Thanks for making Locked On Bucs your first listen or your first view today. And every day, thanks as always for coming through on a regular basis like you do. Football season is here, so make sure you're kicking up your coverage with Locked On NFL Kickoff Live every Friday, 2 p.m. Eastern on any Locked On NFL YouTube channel. But also check out Locked On Sports Today, our 24/7 live channel on YouTube, the first of its kind. You get Locked On Sports 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's Locked On Sports Today on your YouTube dial. Find it live everywhere you find YouTube, right? Time to stash it and trash it. James is not here, but he has sent me what he wants to stash and what he wants to trash. And because he is not here and he is rude and he is taking a day off like I never do. Yeah, it's a lie. I'm going to start with my own personal stash. My personal stash coming out of week 11, defensive effort. And yes, I'm not joking. Stop laughing. Stop it. Stop laughing. I'm serious, guys. Look. Obviously, the game wasn't perfect. We just finished going over a lot of Devin White, not good stuff from this game. Big passes, touchdowns, you give up 27 points. As a defense, you never walk out of a game saying 27 points. Oh, we had a really good day. But when you contextualize everything, by the way, Brock Purdy put up a 158.3 quarterback rating. So listen, even as I wrote this part of the show, I was like, am I really about to say this on recording on so many different platforms that can be used against me moving forward? Absolutely, I am. Because at the end of the day, if you wipe out the offensive mistakes, the fumble early, the interception, there's some just executional things that just, you know, lead to plays not being successful. There don't have to be dramatic changes, but drops, officials doing their job would help. If you take away some of those things, and more on those coming up in a bit, the defense gives the Buccaneers a chance to win this game. And I say that because I'm talking about this game. Because to beat the San Francisco 49ers, you have to score points. Like, you can't come into the San Francisco 49ers game on your schedule, I don't care who you are, and say, all right, defense, we're going to win this because you're going to hold them to 10 points. You're going to hold them to 17 points. I'll tell you right now, it is incredibly unlikely that you are going to keep this offense under 30 points. I wrote an article on BucsGameDay.com. Nick Wright said that he thinks Baker Mayfield is a better quarterback than Brock Purdy. Look, I'm not really here to debate which of those two quarterbacks is the better quarterback, but I'm just going to tell you right now, one of those quarterbacks, their offense, when they have their weapons available, is putting up 30 points on the regular. The other quarterback, when he has all his weapons available, they're putting up 20 points kind of regularly. Okay. So again, situations, schemes, context, weapons, defense, it all plays a part in it, right? Brock Purdy's not out there doing it alone. Baker Mayfield's not out there doing it alone. So I'm not going to give either of them total credit for what's going on with their team or blame. But the bottom line is San Francisco's only been held under 30 points once this season when Deebo Samuel was healthy. The only defense to keep the San Francisco 49ers offense under 30 points when Deebo Samuel, Christian McCaffrey, Brandon Ayuk, George Kittle, and Brock Purdy, and Trent Williams are all on the field, Tampa Bay Buccaneers. They're the only ones that have done it. And yes, they gave up 27 points. But again, if you want to beat the 49ers, that's what it's going to take. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's what it's going to... You have to come into a 49ers game saying, we got to put up 30. Like, that's just being realistic. If you're a coach in the NFL and you're going out there and saying, we're going to be the guys. It's going to be us, guys. Nobody else can do it, but we're going to be the ones to keep the Niners from getting to 30 points. You're delusional. Just being honest, you're delusional. You're not coaching up to your opponent. You need to expect to need at least 30 points. So the defense gave up 27. It's not a whole lot less than 30, but it's less than 30. Now, it didn't work this weekend, but my point is, if you get the same level of focus, if you get the same level of effort, if you get the same level of performance against the 49ers offense, then you get that same performance against these other offenses coming up, the Colts, the Panthers, the Saints, the Falcons, the Packers, the Jaguars, the Panthers again, you will be in position to win all of those games, every one of those games. And obviously health has to do with it. And yes, I know Jamel Dean gave up a deep ball, but that's basically my point here, is a 27 point effort against the San Francisco 49ers defensively is akin to keeping your other opponents under 21, 24 points, 20 points. You know what I'm saying? Because that's how prolific this 49ers offense has been and can be. So the other side of that coin, though, is your offense has to score more or enough points to make good on that defensive effort. More on that here in just a little bit. So that's my stash. I know it sounds kind of crazy, but again, contextually, when you talk about playing the 49ers, and you know, if you can get better Devin White play, that'd be amazing as well. Certainly go a long way. James's stash, continued increased workload for Yaya Diaby. Yaya Diaby played 35% of defensive snaps on Sunday, still needs to get more. More on that coming up in segment three. 4 sacks on the season now after the 49ers game, 2 on Sunday alone, tied for second among all rookies. He's also got 7 tackles for loss, also tied for second most among the rookies. More sacks than Joe Tryon-Shoyinka. Same sack total as Shaquille Barrett on the year with far less opportunity. Keep increasing those snaps for Yaya and good things are going to happen. James, I couldn't agree more. Todd Bowles doesn't seem to fully agree, but we're going to talk about that. James is trash. Devin Tompkins returning kicks. We love Devin Tompkins. James loves him. I love him. But twice on Sunday, he returned kicks and failed to even make it out to the 25-yard line. One return was also called back on a penalty, setting the Bucs up to start at their own 10-yard line. Nowhere close to ever breaking off a big return. I wouldn't say ever, but I get James's point, and it's hurting the offense. Certainly, that's the fact. San Francisco is not an outlier. He consistently comes up short of the 25-yard line on kick returns, and it's always a net win for the opposing team when that happens. Take the touchback or fair catch it and start with the ball at 25 because Devin Tompkins' return ability has just not been there this season. I agree with that as well. My trash it. Baker Mayfield's passing efficiency, and I'm not talking touchdowns to interceptions. 7 touchdowns, 2 interceptions over the last 4 games. That's beautiful. What I'm talking about right now is Baker Mayfield is 9th in net passing yards, 8th in yards per attempt coming into week 11. The problem is those attempts could have or even should have produced even more because in the past 4 weeks, Baker Mayfield has only thrown 76% of his passes that get graded out as catchable by Sports Info Solutions. That's catchable. It's not completions. That's catchable. So when only 76% of your passes are catchable, it's really hard to have even a 70% completion rate. That means for every 10 passes he's throwing in the last 4 weeks or coming into the last quarter of the season, about 2.5 of them don't even have a chance of being caught. Now, some of those are throwaways and some of those are smart throwaways. So you have to give a little bit of room for that. But you don't want to get too crazy with the criticism. But if even 3 of those 6 per game are made catchable, that jumps his catchable rate up to 88%. That jumps your percentage completion percentage up probably closer to 78%, 75%. The Bucs are 1-3 in the last 4 games before. Well, so now they're still 1-3 in the last 4 games, but they were 1-3 coming into these numbers and only scored 20 points or more twice. In the first 4 weeks of the season, Baker Mayfield's catchable rate was 83%. His net yards were 16. So his net yards were lower, but his catchable percentage was higher, which means his completion percentage was likely higher. And he had 20 and they produced 20 more points in every game except for the loss to the Eagles, which, I mean, the Eagles just held the Chiefs 17 points. So, you know, there's only so much you can do. So we need to see that completion, not the completion number, the catchable rate for Baker Mayfield go back up because that will help balance with the defense. And again, if you can get that defensive performance, defensive effort and attention to detail like they had against the Niners, against teams like the Colts, the Panthers, and the Falcons. And Baker Mayfield gets that catchable rate back up, should be able to come out of this next three-game stretch 1-2 or 2-1 or maybe even 3-0. So that's what James and I want to see. What does Todd Bowles think? We're going to talk about that coming up next on today's episode of Locked On Bucs, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. Today's episode of Locked On Bucs brought to you by FanDuel. Score this NFL season with FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. Right now, new customers get $150 in bonus bets with any winning $5 money line bet. That's $150 if your team wins. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers are projected to lose a second straight road game this weekend facing the Indianapolis Colts at Lucas Oil Stadium. Right now, that line has the Bucs as 2.5-point underdogs. But if you think they can pull off the upset, sign up, drop that money line bet on the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And if they do it, you win as well. However, if you're a Bucs fan and you just think there's no way they're going to upset the Colts, sign up, drop that money line bet on Indy. And if they lose, if the Bucs lose, you might get your silver lining with a personal win. If you've been thinking about joining FanDuel, there's no better time to get in on the action. The app is easy to use, and there's a wide range of betting options, including spreads, player props, over-unders, and more. So go to FanDuel.com/lockedon and score this NFL season. FanDuel, official partner of the National Football League. We are wrapping up today's episode talking about Todd. We're looking at a couple quotes from Todd Bowles, his Monday press conference that stuck out to me. And unfortunately, usually following after a loss, they're going to stand out for not so good reasons. One of the things that James Yarcho said was his stash was more playing time for Yaya Diaby. Todd Bowles was asked about giving outside linebacker Joe Tryon-Shoyinka more snaps than outside linebacker Yaya Diaby. And Todd Bowles said, quote, "We do different things a lot of times. With a lot of people on there. We don't have a justification for it when we rotate our guys. Our stats are going to always look different for different guys. Yaya had a lot of production yesterday, and I'm happy he did. He plays a lot, and he'll play for more for us." So the good news there is that Todd says at the end, he'll play more for us. So that hints that Yaya is going to get more play time, right? And that's exactly what James wants, exactly what I want, should be exactly what you want watching these games. What I don't like about that answer, and this could just be me splitting hairs, but just what I don't like about that answer is the part where Todd Bowles says, quote, "We don't have a justification for it when we rotate our guys," end quote. Bro, you need to have a reason you're doing what you're doing. Like, everything on the football field is important, right? We just watched this game where an uncharacteristic fumble drops, missed flags, you know what I mean? And that's leaving up to chance. And then what? Like, a major explosive play, extra level of explosive play to Brandon Ayuk. Like, the NFL is a game of inches. That's not just a cliche. That's fact. So everything you do on the football field has to have a reason. There has to be a so what. Like, if I'm telling this player, hey, drop in this quarter zone, why? There's a reason for it. If I'm telling you to play press man, why? There's a reason for it. If I'm putting a dude on the field, there needs to be a reason for it. Like, that's the basis of leadership. Leadership, at the bare minimum, leadership is providing purpose, direction, and motivation. Minimum. If you're not doing those three things, you're not a leader, period. Or if you're in a leadership position, you're a failure as a leader. So you put Yaya Diaby on the field, or Joe Tryon-Shoyinka on the field, or Shaquille Barrett, or whoever in this rotation, if you don't have a justification for why you're doing it, you're not giving those guys a purpose. And if they know you have no rhyme or reason for why they're on the field, they have no motivation. They might have direction, right? The play call says, rush the A-gap, rush the edge, do this, do that. Okay, so they got direction. So you're getting 1 out of 3. Well, I don't care what Meatloaf says. 1 out of 3 is terrible. So I'm hoping I'm just picking right here. But if that's true, if they're just like, get in. No reason. Just go for it, bro. Nah, man. You got to have a better reason than that. If there's a reason Yaya Diaby played less than Joe Tryon-Shoyinka, if Yaya Diaby was playing better. Fair question. Todd said this, quote, "He didn't get his sacks all in the first quarter. Like, when we say, let's stay with him, he's on a 50-point night like basketball. He got them throughout the game, and he got them week in and week out. He's been making some splash plays, but understanding the scheme is way more important of what we have to do as well, and he's coming along with that. We're fine at the pace we have him in, and we have a plan for him," end quote. Here's what I would tell you. Your plan when you're okay. So now we're talking about the development of a player, right? We're talking about the intellectual understanding of a player. And here's my philosophy on this kind of stuff. And I don't care what line of business you're in, football, basketball, business, finance, whatever you're in. If you have a person, if you have an asset, right? Let's break it down in business terms. If you have an asset that is performing better than expected, you want to then put that asset in a position to flourish by either putting it in that successful environment more or increasing the opportunity of the environment, increasing the scope of the environment to see if that asset will now produce even better when given those other opportunities. Now, a guy like Yaya Diaby, I'm not sitting here saying, okay, let's make him a cornerback. Like, he's doing really good as an outside linebacker. Let's make him a corner. No, that's all I'm saying. But so in this scenario, this context, you would say we have this asset who's doing really well as an outside rush linebacker. Let's rush him more and see if he grows even more. Now, is it possible that he doesn't grow even more? Absolutely. You give him 20 or 35% of snaps and he gets 2 sacks. Does that mean if you give him 70%, he's going to get 4 sacks? Not necessarily, right? But if you give him 70%, does he get 2.5 sacks? Does he get 3 sacks? Potentially. The only way to find out is to put him on the field and to say, we have a plan, tells me that what your plan is more important than what the player is showing you. And that is, again, we go back to purpose, direction, motivation. That is not how you motivate your players. Your players are motivated by, if I play really well, I play more. If I play more and I play really well, I get paid. That is how, that's what these players, like outside of just the love of football, love of competing and playing for your brothers, that is what these guys are on the field to do. If you're not rewarding really good play with more opportunity, you again are not doing one of the three basic tenets of leadership, which is motivating your players and also giving them purpose. Because what's the point? If I'm not like, if your job, if your picture of me, coach, is that I'm not going to play more than 35% of snaps till week 17 of this season, no matter what I do, well, guess what? It's week 12. I got 5 more weeks till I can even sniff more than 35% of snaps. Why am I even going to do this? And again, outside of love of football, love for the brothers, love of competition, you have to provide that extra motivation. So that's what I'm going to say about that. I will say that I do agree with Todd Bowles. It's not like, you know, it's not like Yaya had like 2 sacks on 4 snaps and it's like, oh man, like this dude's on fire. They can't block him. So I will give him some credit on that. The last thing I'll say about this is we used to have this conversation all the time in the Army. Would you rather have the soldier that can tell you everything that you need to do on the battlefield? Or would you rather have the soldier that can do everything you need to do on the battlefield? Me, I'd rather have the dude that can do it. Because at the end of the day, if we're in the middle of a firefight, you might be able to tell me the max effective range of your weapon, how to zero your weapon, the best way to qualify with your weapon, and the best tactic to use to take that hill or whatever it is we're going up against. But if you can't actually do it, I'm going to leave you back home. I'm going to take the dude that can do it. So that's what I would say about this. If Yaya Diaby is getting the job done, I don't care that Joe Tryon-Shoyinka can regurgitate your scheme to you better and instruct your scheme better than Yaya can. If Yaya can execute the scheme better, put Yaya in. That's my last thought on that. That's talking about Todd. Coming up tomorrow, we got Evan Klosky joining James Yarcho for WTSP Wednesday. Come back for that every day. In the meantime, if you got questions, comments, leave them in the YouTube comment section. Hit me on Twitter or hit James on Twitter at @JYarcho_Bucs, or just text James and tell him what you think about me, because that's always a good time. Join subtext.com/LockedOnBucs. Thank you so much for making Locked On Bucs your first listen or your first view today and every day. Make sure that you make us part of your everyday routine. Every day, we love you. We appreciate you for coming through. Until we speak again, please be safe, be kind, fire the See you next time for another episode of Locked On Bucs, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.